Parents strongly caution the following programs are intended for mature audiences over the age of 18. These programs may contain some material that many parents would not find suitable for children and may include intense violence, sexual situations, coarse language, and suggestive dialogue.
You didn't start it correctly, you jackass. I said Clockwork Orange music. Clockwork Orange music. Where is the Clockwork Orange music? This is supposed to be engineering the show. I've gotten my wish. Now I will do the show on my own. I don't care if he walks out. I gave him the notes. Did I not give him the notes? I said, play the Clockwork Orange. Start with the Clockwork Orange.
It's hard to hear it in these headphones.
But I gave him the notes. The blueprint of the show is right in front of him.
So press play in the Clockwork.
Hold on. I have to come to the other side of the console now. Hold on. Hold on, everybody. Damn it. Damn it. What a goddamn waste of my life this show has become. Hold on. Put on my goddamn headphones correctly. Now, where is the Clockwork Orange damn CD? It's right here. It wasn't even in the damn machine. I'm doing my show the way I want it to begin it. Where is it? Closing the thing. I'm closing this. I don't even know how to close a CD player. Am I even on the air? Jesus! Hi, welcome to No Positive Radio. We'll begin in about 13 minutes. Son of a bitch. That's all I have to say. I'm gonna begin the way I want to. Yes. Well, welcome, welcome, listeners. Already one of us has stormed out of the building. Sir Dirtus of the East Farthing has left the building. And how do I do this on my own? Why, I give the other microphone to the Miracle Mark Wilcox. You will not join my round table? You blaspheme! How darest thou? Come to my round table. This the round table of false equality and civil disobedience. And I, of course, ladies and gentlemen, I am King Paul of the uninitiated rabble. I am King Paul of the unmanaged yet naturalized anger. Yes, that's right. Ah, sweet and lovely this music be. Come, Lucian, come. Bringeth the mead and fineries of red meat and bone. Tonight all shall feast. Even the dogs shall fatten themselves on scraps and morsels of tender loin chops. Damn this world, if it's not correct, I don't know what is. I bring you here to my round table. My round table, as I said, of false equality and civil disobedience for a reason today, ladies and gentlemen. To bring you news. My microphone has come off. I feel like a goddamn game show host. I wish you people at home could see my goddamn mic. Game show host, hey, I've got a mic with rigging all over it. I'm walking around. This mic weighs more than a small goddamn dog.
No, that's the end of that. That was my brilliant introduction.
I was hoping my brilliant introduction was going to be smooth and unshambled. But of course...
Unbelievable.
Okay, for all of you who don't know what happened at the beginning there, I yelled at Dirty John and he said, what was his exact quote?
I want to remove myself from the situation.
He said, fine then, you do the show yourself. And he walked out and he slammed the door.
I got it.
He slammed the goddamn door, Bill Parker. He slammed the door, Miracle Mark Wilcox, on me.
He was not happy.
He's going to get 2 demerits for this, is all I'm going to say. He may be suspended.
He's very tired.
Well, screw him. I gave him the goddamn notes how to start the show, and as usual, he F's my show straight to hell. My show has gone to hell in a handbasket.
Well, look at
Lucky
this.
I've got a long rope to go down into hell and get the handbasket with the fishing hook and bring it the frig back up.
Look what he has to do before the show. He's got to get it all set up.
He wired it up, but still, his job is to engineer my goddamn show. You know what I'm saying? To engineer my goddamn show. To engineer my goddamn show. Right? Thanks for the vote of confidence, ye of my round table. Christ, how am I going to become king of men with this type of attitude surrounding me? I don't know.
Where do you think he went?
To the crying hole, perhaps. Don't turn your head, the world can hear you laughing, you traitorous prick, you Miracle Mark Wilcox. So we're supposed to play our first concert, you know, with the Reformed Cringe on Tuesday. Is that going to happen now?
I think it's over. That was short-lived.
Holy Christ, is that weird? You're not! No, it's Ryan Garmasol! That's a good... I'll take Ryan Garmasol any day over Dirty John. What's up, Ryan?
Come on now.
I did not pull the rigging off of this microphone. This thing fell into my hand, and now I'm dealing with it. And I actually feel comfortable with the grip I have on this manly phallus of a microphone here. So that was my opening. I had a little bit of medieval merriment music. I addressed the crowd. But if, as always, in the world of No Positive Radio, things are unpredictable and quasi-spontaneous. I've had way too much coffee this afternoon. I'm trying to, choke down 5 pounds of water to dilute the acid building up in my stomach. Even my crap is taking craps. I've had so much coffee in my system right now. It's weird. It's unnatural. So, yeah, we're back. We're talking. It's another hour of BS with a BS artist. Dirty John stormed out. That was not part of the act,
I saw it coming.
Quote unquote.
I saw it coming.
But you know what kills me? What aggravates me is I say, you're supposed to play the Clockwork Orange music. He looks at me like he has no idea what I'm talking about. As opposed to just saying, oh crap, I made a little mistake. Let's put that in. Make a joke of it. You know, banter around it with a little bit. I'm not going to take your calls. You want to hear the sound of what I hear ringing in my ears all day? Here it is. Ready? Try doing a radio show with a little of this action. Ready? Bless us, everyone! Even you, Tiny Tim, with your gimp leg.
That could be Dirty John calling.
Oh, God. Now he hung up. You heard. You spoiled it. He heard you. So, yeah, well, the cringe, apparently, Miracle Mark Wilcox, myself, Dirty John, Winterbottom, and Mad Matt Matthews on bass. We're going to be playing. Ryan Garmasol is promoting a show. What, you don't want to talk about it? Come on, would you stop? What is this? Why does everyone become so sensitive? Ryan's like, I don't want to talk. I love you. I want to hug you. Come here, please. Please. Say a little something about it. Talk it up a little bit.
What's up, dude?
What's up? How are you?
I'm doing okay.
Ryan Garmasol.
I'm chilling, hanging out.
So you're producing and promoting this show at The Call Tuesday night.
Word.
With Oil Can Boyd.
Oil Can Boyd. Yes, the Cringe and the Oil Can Boyd.
And us, the Cringe. What a double bill.
You know.
Fierce.
That's what I'm saying.
Frenetic. I'm saying. Kinetic. Yeah. Ferocious.
It's going to be hot. Yeah, you got all that stuff, and then you add, dollar drafts into the mix, and then it's just out of control.
Really? Dollar drafts?
Yeah, yeah.
Because I'm low on cash. How am I going to play if I can't drink like a sow? Do sows drink?
Well,
I don't know.
Well, you're a rock star. I think they just give you drinks.
They just... it's poured down my throat
maybe.
In between being fed grapes.
That's
right?
True.
It's all a joke. I go out there look like I'm rough and raw, but in essence, I'm king of all men. I'm king of the Jews!
Oh, Jesus.
Hey, I'm king of the Jews! What are you laughing at? Hey, everybody, welcome to Miss America!
So, yeah, I was thinking of either showing up at the show or possibly faking my own death on Tuesday.
Oh.
I don't know yet. Perhaps the show will go in such a way that it'll appear that I've faked my own death.
Gotcha.
As I'm swinging from a fashioned noose from the rigging. I've said rigging 6 or 7 times this hour. So, I don't know. So, it's Tuesday night.
Tuesday night at the call.
What time are we... what time are we supposed to be there?
I don't know, man. Whenever you want to show up.
I'm going to show up... But if you're fortunate. I'm going to show up 50 minutes after we're supposed to go on. That's what I'm going to do. And I'm going to be on Quaaludes. Do they even make Quaaludes anymore?
I don't know, man.
I get them at CVS?
You should be able to by now.
Oh, man. What a night. Did you see that? Did you see what happened?
No, dude. I was... They're having a thing downstairs.
A festival downstairs.
DJing a little bit, and my partner just took over, so I came up to say hi, and I did not... I missed... What? Give me a summary here.
I gave Dirty John Winterbottom, my minister of all that's electronically motivated, the notes and the CDs, and he did not have them appropriately ready in time, and I simply chastised him with words of chastision. Are you seeing what
I'm
saying?
I mean...
And he stormed out!
Not for nothing, bro.
No, I know. I'm a little rough.
But we've been working together for a long time, and I know that you are, you know, sort of a perfectionist when it comes to this stuff, and a lot of work, a lot of effort goes into your show.
I basically think I gave him an emotional fat lip.
I think so. And I think...
I did that.
You can't hold people to the standards that you hold yourself.
No, you're right. You know, when you are perfect and, you know, the second coming, like me, you know, it is difficult to look down on lower and lesser beings.
Do you see what I'm saying? Now you see what I'm saying.
I mean, how do I even draw sympathy when I've never known such a thing?
That's right.
When I've never known such a thing as sympathy because I'm all powerful and perfect. And I'm presumptuous. And proper, and that's all the P words I know.
Right? Purdy,
pee pee, that's not a P word. So now I'm sitting here holding a broken microphone in my hand with a broken show, and Dirty Joe Winterbottom crying underneath my car, hanging on to it, Robert De Niro a la Cape Fear style, as I go on a cross country trip to my vacation spot, only to find out that he had clung to the bottom of the car the whole time in order to put his thumb in my daughter's mouth. It's weird. Everybody's abandoning that mic like the goddamn plague. The mic does not have strep A.
I
don't know. It's all broken. This station is broken, and I don't think I'm doing anything to help.
57.
So I want to talk a little bit here. I want to talk about a few stories today. I want to tell a few stories today. I don't even know. I've got crappy-ass notes. I'm supposed to be working without notes. That was my new theory. No more notes. All spontaneity. And that has blown up my face, much as my friendship with Dirty John Winterbottom. See, it's all metaphorical in my life. Everything is an illusion, an allegory. Everything is a poem, per se. Right? A poem. And I'm a great poet of ye olden times. How are you? I want to ask you people at home, how are you? I hope you know I thought of you this week. I got some nice emails this week, and one from James, and another one from another guy. We'll call him Jimmy. You know, I was going to say, you know what just popped into my head? Golgotha. Does anyone in this room know what Golgotha is?
No.
It's not a hardcore band, Bill. I know your thoughts are all hardcore all day. But Golgotha was actually the... in Hebrew, it means the place of skulls, and it's where they put Jesus' crucifix when they crucified him. It was like the little dirt hill that they crucified him in. Well, there were two thieves next to him, Barabbas. Oh, Jesus, Barabbas, and who was the other one? Does anybody know? I was going to say Jimmy, but I'm not sure there were any Jimmys in the days of the Jesus and the Romans. I don't think there were any Jimmys yet. Jimmy had not been invented yet. But I was thinking how interesting it would be. I would like to go to Golgotha, because I see a lot of similarities between myself and Jesus Christ. On a daily basis, I start seeing things. For instance, Jesus Christ, while he was alive, nobody took him that seriously except for maybe 7 or 8 or 9 people, right? But when he died, he became king of men. And his word and his prophecy and his message became followed by 1 billion people. And I'm inviting somebody to crucify me. I think that it's the most important step in my radio career is to be crucified. As a matter of fact, I want to travel to Golgotha, and I just want to chew on mouthfuls of that dirt in Golgotha. Is that so? Come in! What are you doing in the hallway?
Hey.
Don't watch the show from the hallway. Come in. Talk it out. Please talk it out with me. Talk it out with me. If I bring you a mic out there, will you talk it out with me?
Back, Shane. Come back.
Come on, talk it out.
I want to see how this goes with you having to figure shit out on your own.
I'm fine. We're on the air. We are broadcasting. The levels look a little sharp. But I know that's not to be worried about.
That's why there's a mic in your hand.
It fell off the rigging. The rigging broke in my hand. Get on the mic. Dirty John, seriously.
No.
Come on. Please, this is ridiculous. How we have to play a show on Tuesday night, a whirlwind return to form for the cringe, and here it is, a problem.
You can start by apologizing to him. Jesus.
Father, forgive Dirty John. He knows not what he does to me. Dirty John, I apologize. I snapped at you, but I snapped at you in kind of a quasi ridiculous way. I wasn't snapping at you real. I was snapping at you off the cuff in radio lingo. I gave you the CDs and the notes, and I told you how to run it, and it wasn't run properly. Now, granted, you have a million things. You've got to rewire this entire studio for it to work, correct? And I understand and appreciate that very, very much. But the point is, on top of all that, once the music is playing, you got to be in the zone with me here. We got to be flowing together, like raindrops off of rooftops, right? In sweet May. Right? I agree. I completely agree, Dirty John. I was right all along. I mean, why was I apologizing in the goddamn first place? Can you talk to me, please?
No, go ahead.
No, talk.
You're losing time.
I don't care. I'll spend the whole hour waiting for you to talk, if that's what it's going to take. Providence is waiting for your word here. For your word. I think maybe you should say, you know what? You didn't have the right to snap at me, but maybe I should have had the CD ready. Maybe. You won't even give me half of that? You won't go anywhere near that? Oh, yes, son of a bitch, you're making this difficult. Fine, I'll just go on without you. Forever. You're fired from the show. Forever. You're suspended for 2 weeks from the show. 2 weeks of suspension. Bill Parker, you are suspended for 1 week. But after this, because I need you on my team right now, because I'm feeling a little shallow. I'll kill you! I'm spitting in my mouth. I need a sip of water. Hold on. Ladies and gentlemen, home, this is not a joke or an act. Dirty John Winterbottom is legitimately angry at me right now. I had no choice in this matter here. I lost my temper. What more can I say? I'm King Paul of the unmanaged and naturalized anger. I said that at the beginning of the show. You were in the hall pouting. You didn't hear me say it. Can you please come on the mic and talk to me? Please? Okay, the hell with you. You're fired from the cringe. You're fired from the radio show. You're fired from the cringe. We need a replacement guitarist. Stat. Go out in the hall and find somebody. Quick. Miracle Mark. What?
We're doing so well on the bass search.
Well, we have pretty good.
We can replace the main songwriter and guitar player. Easily.
Look who is stepping up to the plate to take... Oh, you're going to get him mad at you, too.
He's not mad at me.
No, he's not mad. Who?
I didn't want to look for him.
I can't tell if he's mad or not. You know what it is? He's very tired and aggravated. You're tired today. And you're moody. You're grumpy.
He is.
Are you going to deny that you're grumpy? Deny it. Well, say they can't see you nodding your head. They think I'm crazy. Can you say I am grumpy today at least?
Why you just did?
This is a great show.
Play the song.
For the next 45 minutes, you're going to hear the sweet sounds of noose fashioning. I'm going to take little pieces of twine. I'm going to fashion them together to hang myself. I might even hang myself with my own sadness. Frankly, I'll use my own sadness as a rope. What do you think, Mark? Why are you nodding your head? This isn't television! You have to be vocal! Can you hold this? I need primal scream therapy right now. Hold this. What I want to do is I need to... Hold the goddamn mic! I'll hook it up. Is it too much for you? I can't get it back on the stick. I can't do it! Please, can you hold it?
Dirty John is looking at...
Hold it. What I'm going to do is I'm having anxiety right now.
All
right. Literally, my heart is going too fast. I'm anxious because of this. I'm anxious because we have to play Tuesday night, and I do not believe in the facilities of rock and roll anymore. And I'm anxious because I have 40 minutes, and I'm very upset right now with you. I'm upset. I apologize. You did not accept my apology. So therefore, now I'm just angry. And I'm going to do some primal scream therapy in order to get some chap off my chest in order to continue. Here. Mark, will you be my mic stand? I do. Hold it up. I can't do it with you looking at me. Don't look at me. Can you turn your head?
You want me to come in here?
I don't want you to look at me right now, though, when I do it. I don't want you to see me. The contortions of my face, I don't want you to see them. Will you just seriously turn your head for a few minutes? Thank you. Don't look. You got peripheral vision. You can see me in your periphery. Just look at the...
I'm not going to hold the mic forever.
Are you getting tired? Let me have a sip of water first. Don't move it away! Primal screams. Take one. Ah! Ah! Oh. I'm so lightheaded. Oh my god. I feel worse. I think that's what it, is that what it's supposed to do? Are you supposed to feel worse? I'm feeling stiff now. Very stiff. You're about to hear the sweet sounds of a nervous breakdown live in the air. All right, ladies and gentlemen, let's talk a little bit together. Let's just talk. God knows what we're going to talk about. I'm sick to my goddamn stomach. That's what I'm sick of. I'm going to put in another music bed. Calm me the hell down. Dirty John can't do this, and now I have to do it. I have to do everything myself in this goddamn world. This is the thing you learn. You learn you gotta just do everything your goddamn self. Let's see what music we have here. What do we have? Is it gonna work? Let me guess. The CD player is also going to rebel against me, you son of a something or other, you son of a bastard. Where is it? You know, play. It's not gonna play. This is fabulous. I don't know about you, but I think this is what radio should be. This is the next evolution of radio. Bullshit over and over and over again, right? Week after week of nothing. Week after week of generalized apathy disorder. Now it won't let me have my CD back. Can you please, please at least do that for me? I can't figure everything out. I don't know the technology. You are the minister of all that's electronically motivated.
This one?
No, underneath.
There's nothing in here.
Are you sure?
Well, do you see any numbers?
No, it's doing this. It won't open. I want it. There it goes, right? It will be in there. Oh my god, I can't get the CD out. I'm just gonna kill myself. So, Tuesday night, ladies and gentlemen, as far as I know, we're going to be the Cringe will be playing at the Call on Elbow Street in Providence. And if you don't know where that is, I think you can go to www.thecall.com and they can get some directions. Just follow the prompts. I'd love people who listen to the show to come down and see the show, and I'm gonna tell you why. Why? Because I. Do you hear anything? Three? No. Yes.
He's back.
I hear it. Give it to me nice and loud for a few minutes. I need to calm myself down. I feel sick to my goddamn gizzards right now. Sounds like Jaws, but I know it's not. It's from, what? How do you pronounce this composer's name?
Gorecki. I think.
You know, you have Beethoven, you have Mozart, and like, hey guys, I'm Gorecki. Can I come join your club and compose? Did I mention my name's Gorecki? And Beethoven and Mozart are like, who is this queer? This guy is queer. Do we let the queer guy, or he's going to make a lawsuit if we don't let him compose with us? I want to tell you something, ladies and gentlemen. We're going to be performing Tuesday night. Now, I'm going to tell you the most ironic part is I've lost complete faith. I don't believe in the institution of rock and roll. I haven't believed in it in a long time. I took hot lead for the institution of rock and roll. It failed me completely. Miracle Mark Wilcox continued on after the Cringe. Dirty John Winterbottom continued on after the Cringe in one form or another. However, I could not continue on after the Cringe, and there are very few simple reasons why. And I'm going to outline them to you today so that you could come to the show on Tuesday night and you can see me faking, being a liar and faking and faking and faking to you and being dishonest with you. When I'm here in the radio studio, at least I honestly lie to you. But when you're going to see me on stage, it's all a manufactured lie. It's all complete. It's crippling. What are you doing?
Just keep talking.
So I feel weird. What are you going to steal this from me too? Steal my lifeblood? Now you take my microphones. It's fabulous. I want to tell you a couple of things, a few of my thoughts. The reason why I don't believe in rock and roll is simply because it exists as, you know, the muscle memory of a mundane and bloodless rebellion, okay? It's a creation, it's a rebellion that was really never meant to exist in its primary form, but only as a theatrical display. So that kind of invalidates it as something that's real and something that's tangible and something that really can provoke and you know, include people that aren't directly included in it. Do you see what I'm saying? The candor and brutality and eager wastefulness of rock and roll was manufactured to be manufactured, even upon its conception and induction as a social stance, okay? I have to tell you people a secret. Rock and roll and playing in a band and singing and the lyrics and the whole thing, it's been my only... The closest thing I can equate to spirituality I've ever had in my entire life. You know, I'm not going to bullshit you. I'm going to tell it to you honestly. You want that one? I want this one? Oh, you're going to hook this up while I talk into this. I love you. Do you people at home realize how much I love you? Maybe you don't. Maybe you think that I'm cold and calculated and callous. But the truth of the matter is, yes, I sit here and I lie to you and I work off of notes and I pretend to be somebody I'm not, week after goddamn week after goddamn week. But I'm trying to be honest with you here because I'm facing something very terrifying, and that's in a couple of days, 48 hours from now, I have to perform on a stage and sing songs that I no longer believe in. And sit there and conduct this tremendous burst of electricity behind me and conduct a tremendous amount of energy from in front of me, from human beings, from human entities. I have to conduct this energy, and I have no business doing it anymore. I feel like I've lost my complete control over everything about it, you know? And maybe that's exactly why I should be doing it. I have no idea, but I'm going to tell you something. Singing with the band, singing with the cringe nowadays is the only time in my life that I feel completely orchestrated and conditioned. Do you understand? Never mind. Don't even get me started on the goddamn Western preoccupation with the guitar. I have absolutely no idea about that. Dirty John Winterbottom, my favorite guitarist of all time, even outside of this tiff we're in, my favorite guitarist of all time. I believe Dirty John Winterbottom writes the greatest licks, probably one of the top five greatest lick writers in the history of rock and roll. Miracle Mark may disagree. I'm just telling you my thoughts. I look back through my entire life, and I feel like that this path was laid out in front of me, and I really had no choice in this path. I call the path rock and roll, which is so sickening and cliched, because the idea of rock and roll hit the ceiling 30 years ago and could not evolve any further, yet everybody consistently tries to feed energy into it, and for into what ends? And for what means? What does it feed back to me? What did it feed back to me? Misery. Displacement. Apathy. That's what it fed back to me. Did it bring me anything? Does this radio show, has it brought me anything? It hasn't brought me a goddamn thing. What have I gotten from any of this? What have I gotten from standing at this pulpit and talking in the first place? It's all complete and total BS. I wish I could say everything I want to say, but I'm not allowed to swear on the American airwaves. And people say, well, you should be more intelligent than to just have to revert to vulgarities. But this is the cadence and the rhythm of my own speech, and I can't even talk like I talk on the air. So how can I truly be honest with you? How can I truly express myself in an honest and meaningful way when I am as manufactured as the electromagnetic signals that are being conducted by your goddamn radios and your car stereos? It's all pompous and ridiculous, and pomposity is something I want to touch on. I want to touch on pomposity. I want to touch on it. I want to touch on it. I want to touch on it. Because in rock and roll, ladies and gentlemen, the problem, the ultimate problem lies in the fact that nothing in rock and roll is perpetual. Everything has become completely adjacent. Okay, that's what I'm trying to say. That's what I want to say. That's exactly what I want to say. My notes don't show me what I want to say. I want to talk. I'm reading my notes because I can't formulate ideas consciously and correctly. Can you hear how fast I'm talking because of the coffee? Does anybody want to hear me? Does anybody out there? Hold on, I'm going to go to the other side.
Okay, now I have the mic, folks. And Paul's in trouble. That mic's off.
Here you say something. That was Larry D who called up.
Oh, what did he have to say?
He said it sounds great, and he said hi to Dirty John.
Well, hello to Larry D.
Larry D, tonight we feed on girl flesh! Girl flesh, damn you!
So anyway, look, one of the major things that I love about being in a band and about what rock and roll is to me, honest to God, is the beautiful, male-oriented, tribalistic kind of bonding experience that exists nowadays besides street gangs, which I have a great amount of respect for. I love the idea of street gangs, especially Asian street gangs, like Japanese street gangs. They ride motorcycles and they're just kind of disobedient, but troublemakers, but they're not evil and manipulative. Rock and roll is the same thing. Rock and roll is one of the last great brotherhoods. And granted, there are women that sing in bands, but what woman ever really did anything positive for rock and roll? I'm going to go on the record as saying that women have wasted the time of rock and roll over and over and over again.
It's not for girls.
Oh, well, the hell with her. The hell with her.
Yeah.
The only reason she succeeded is because she was kind of a man trapped in a woman's body, frankly.
Well, exactly. She did what other women couldn't do.
Rock and roll, being in a band, it's a brilliant, brilliant breeding ground of male bonding. That's what it is. It's a brotherhood. It's a fraternity without being a goddamn sick, crappy fraternity. My brothers, Dirty John Winterbottom, the Miracle Mark Wilcox, how long have we been together doing this endeavor? How long have we been trying as hard as we can and getting nothing out of it? How long have we been sitting here messing around with the pompous perversions of meaningless pomposity and posturing? That's all it is. It's so conditional. I get up on stage and I feel like this is how I'm supposed to behave on a stage. I'm supposed to hold the goddamn mic stand a certain way. I'm supposed to sing a certain way. What am I really communicating to anybody? With goddamn poetry. It's bullshit. It really is. It truly is. It's a sinking ship. And we're doing nothing but kicking more holes into the hull. But I still think you should come on Tuesday night to call and see us. Now, let's talk for a moment. Dirty John. I'll come back to this in a minute. What's going on right now with you? Tell me your emotional state right now.
I am, I don't know. I'm not in a good mood.
Why? Express yourself. Why are you... What's bothering you? What's the heart of the matter? What happened that set you off?
Because you couldn't just start the show. You had to just start attacking.
I know.
When I'm trying to... What's the point in getting your music on if the mics aren't working? You have to do one thing at a time.
I know, but if we have to at least, you know...
And I did not realize you wanted the music right away. I figured you'd do the intros, like every other friggin' show that we do, and then you would have your music come in when you start your little speeches.
I appreciate that.
And that's what I thought was going on.
That I appreciate, to be honest with you. That makes sense to me. And you're right. Maybe I wasn't clear enough with you that was going to be my music for my introduction. Maybe that wasn't clear enough.
But that's right? Not what was making me mad. It's just you couldn't start the show. I needed you to talk, because if I don't hear you talking, then I have no idea if everything we hooked up in here even works.
I know, but my psychic energy is pointed in such a way that I need to create the show that was already created in my brain before we ever stepped in front of microphones. And when little by little, the
isn't the one thing we've learned here in radio is that things do not go as planned.
Which
so
is
you
also
sometimes need to be able to just roll with it.
Which is a very beautiful thing in and of itself.
I know. Well, this is good radio.
The spontaneity of things is beautiful, and I have some respect for it, but I also hate it passionately and with every bone in my spine.
As most other radio stations, you don't have to deal with this crap.
I mean, we have a snake pit of wires that don't need to be here because microphones don't work properly in a goddamn radio station. But I want to go on record as saying one thing about this radio station. I'll complain till I'm blue in the face. I have a deep, deep, truthful, and honest loyalty to this radio station and to the people who run this radio station.
Oh, yeah.
I am in love with this. I am obsessed with it. That's where this passion comes from. I crack on you like that and come down on you only because of my level of passion, and I hope you understand that. But as soon as you walked out of that room, I felt a sickness in my stomach that I can't quite describe with words and actions. I felt a deep sickness of one of the two or three or four people on Earth who I don't truly want to violate, and I felt like I violated you.
Well, I am not having a good day, so half of it is that. But...
Why couldn't you have... when I asked you, is it because you're somewhat grumpy, why couldn't you have just explained that?
But that's not why.
What's the problem, then?
I just felt like you should have just started the show.
But
just
said hello. But that was how something. I wanted to start the show.
Well, great. But I was trying to get to take care of the stuff. Don't you understand?
I was trying to
make your mics work.
I completely understand, and I lost my temper. I lost my temper because I'm full.
And I will apologize for walking out. I shouldn't have done that. It wasn't fair to our audience.
Well, how diplomatic of you. What about me? What about my feelings?
Well,
you don't care.
That's what I'm saying.
I've been sitting here for 5 minutes of my airtime apologizing
to
you.
What about my feelings? I'm sitting here
I said.
Yeah, but it still doesn't change the fact that in the moment you still go right for the attack.
Miracle. It's like he doesn't even hear things I say. He doesn't know how to read between the lines when I talk. God damn it. You only hear exactly what I'm saying. And you're supposed to listen to what I'm saying and interpret it differently.
Okay.
That's what I want from you.
Oh.
Don't you understand that this is a... Look at us, the three of us in this room who are going to take a stage and mount a campaign on a brand new battlefield on Tuesday night. Don't you see the brotherhood?
I think I'm a little worried about that, too. That's the problem.
Yeah, well, I'm full of anxiety. Why? Because of the hierarchy of goddamn influence I feel like I have no choice but to live up to. Do you understand that?
Right.
This goddamn thing, this is my heart, my spirituality. That's the only religion I've ever known. Those are the only prophets, the only priests, the only rabbis, the only gods I've ever known. I've been pumped through stereos, and, you know, I learned about in the back of vans and in dusty basements my whole life. You know, Iggy the goddamn Baptist, and St. Gigi, and Richard Hell of the Unholy Apathy. Do you understand? These people I feel accountable to. I feel accountable to creating something that's not pre-produced and pre-programmed and over, you know, manufactured. And I feel like every time we take the stage, we do nothing but live up to what we're trying to rebel against.
kind of stinks, though, that we have to start all over from scratch again.
I know.
But it's fun, too, you know, having, you know, a first show back. Yeah, it's exciting as well as scary.
But it's frightening and it's distracting, too.
Well, it is, because, you know, back in the day, after a while, it got to the point where just every show we played, it wasn't a big deal. We knew there'd be people there, and it was going to be fun.
I know.
And we were going to do our thing. Now, it's all up in the air right now.
Ladies and gentlemen, when we were in Europe, and we were touring Europe over and over again, two or three full tours of Europe, we would play houses with... People would be... They would have to have police presence in order to keep people from getting in, from sneaking in, from breaking goddamn windows in complete anger that they couldn't get in to see the Cringe play. Mm-hmm. And what were we doing on stage? Why was it such a maddening response? Because they believed we were presenting them something that was real and something that was tangible and alive and organic and elemental. But what were we actually presenting them with? Posturing and nonsense and nothing real. And we knew... that we were the only ones who were in on the joke. And I can't present that anymore. I cannot present that to people anymore. I want people to see my goddamn heart. There are a lot of people out there who probably think that I don't have any goddamn heart. That I'm dead. And I'm the most desensitized and numb person on earth. And you two, amongst Filthy John Monez, Larry D, maybe Bremstyle and Smoking Man, and my mother. Maybe those are the only other people in the world who really understand that I'm truly desensitized to almost everything else, to every other stimulus on earth, except for standing in front of my brothers, and my brothers are playing with loudness and electricity and energy, and it's hitting my back like a hammer of the gods. And I have to conduct that out and be the mouthpiece and feed it to people who feed something back to me, and that's a beautiful religious experience. Like the Doors, like Jim Morrison, and used to say it's the new shamanism. Yeah. Boy, if that's not the most beautiful thing, the simplest and most beautiful way of looking at it. But is it? But maybe it really is new shamanism.
The shaman takes the rest of the tribe or his people through a journey, a spiritual sort of journey, and that's basically what we do to our audience.
Yes, but my feeling and my fear is that it's just as manipulative as any other kind of religion and any other kind of shamanistic experience, where that one person is secretly gaining influence and power and control and manipulative control over people's minds and people's thoughts. It goes down very simple, like I said, elemental means. For instance, Miracle Mark Wilcox and the drums. Those rhythms, you know, speak to very primal, hardwired, you know, facilitations in our brain that makes people move a certain way and feel a certain aggression. What's that? Is it real? Mark, come here. I swear, you son of a bitch. Come over here and talk on the mic. Be heard. This is, you know, Jesus, represent.
I've been talking the whole show.
I'm just anxious.
What do you want me to say?
What do you feel? Do you agree with that? Do you feel a certain power in what you do? I mean, you are the foundation of the music.
Well, I do when people are into it and people are excited about it. If people are feeling it.
But don't you think, you know, when I grew up, I was around the right people who then seemed like the wrong people, but they were the right people. And I'm talking about people, and I say it over there and I say their real names so that the world can hear it and that... You know, time and space can hear it, but it was Doug McCaskill and Roger Campbell and Paul McPhee. These people taught me that even if nobody is there, perform because of the act of performing. Do it because you have nothing else that you can do. You know, build your house, even if no one's going to live there. Mark?
Well, I keep on doing it. We keep on doing it, so we must live by that theory, right?
This music is beautiful, isn't it?
It's amazing.
Speaking of music, don't we have a Cringe song to play?
And we will play it in about 2 minutes, because... Okay. Turn this up. I want the world to hear what beauty is. Beauty is not what we'll do on Tuesday night. This is beauty. Yeah, that's nice. That really centers me. It's like people ask, you know, what music do you listen to? All I've been listening to is classical music, 102.5. That's all I listen to. There's something so amazing and empowering and centering about that kind of music. It makes me feel religious. It makes me feel like I missed the boat with my upbringing and Christianity and all that crap. I watch the EWTN network and I watch the imagery of Jesus and the cross. And
Wait. How did we get into religion off of listening to classical music?
Because I get that feeling.
Oh.
I get a feeling of penitence from it.
Huh.
I feel like my knees have magnets and they want to pull me to the ground and they want me to admit to some higher power that it has control over me, even though for years and years and years I've rebelled against that notion. But you know what? It's the, for me, it's just the God of no, not me moments. You know what I mean? Every time the shit's hitting the fan for me, I'm driving across country when I was with the beautiful Blake Hines, and we break down in the middle of the night in Missouri on a trucking route where it's all giant trucks and we're lost. No way. She broke her timing belt, which is a serious thing to break in your car.
Mm-hmm.
We're lost, and I was walking down the side of that highway with little chiggers getting up in my legs that I could feel biting into my legs with a girl, and I'm the only man, and I'm barely a man. I'm not going to be able to defend us from an angry trucker or some Missouri redneck. And what do I think to myself? Please, Jesus. Please, God. And I remember finally he pointed me into the direction. I saw a light off the road, and it was an old abandoned 1950s gas station. We stood under the one light that worked, and I said, Blake, if we get out of this, I will spend the rest of my life with you. Truthfully. And she said, if we get out of this, I'll spend the rest of my life with you. Do you think I'll ever be able to shed a moment like that? And who presented that moment to me? God! And who do I rebel and swear at and give the finger to 23 out of 24 hours a day? The only time I really think positively of is when my heart's going to stop and I'm dousing my head with freezing cold water. Am I the biggest pussy on earth?
I'm the same way. When everyone asks me what religion am I don't believe in that stuff. Yet, whenever I'm in a dire situation of need, I'm suddenly, God, please, please, let me get through this and this and that. It's you know, hypocritical and everything else, but...
But is that because there's something deep inside of us?
I think it's just a society thing, you know what I mean?
Like, the mass mind mentality that you rebel against.
You make fun of everyone else because they... You say, well, look at them looking up to some spiritual being that you believe doesn't exist, but it seems to help them. So that when you need help, you figure, out what the hell, you know, I guess.
Yeah.
But why should he help me if he really is up there when I go around saying I don't believe he exists? So, it's a frustrating circle.
And you can be a real, you know, wishy-washy son of a bitch and say, well, I'm agnostic, which is that's my smart-ass answer. Well, I'm agnostic. Well, I don't know what exists, and I won't know until I'm there. And if I don't see any belief in it, I can't, you know, say it exists or deny its existence. I'm agnostic. So it's like I walk such a freakish line, you know what I mean? I say to myself, my rationalization for my spiritual emptiness is that if there is some sort of higher power, I believe that he will respect me for having stood on my own two feet my entire life. But how come when one of my legs gives way, I always call out? I always end up calling out to that empty presence.
Yeah. It's all really a question of as stereotypical or cheesy as it sounds to say, it's all a question of faith. You know what I mean?
I was praying that you would come back in the room. I was praying that you weren't going to say, screw you, I'm not playing Tuesday night. Screw you, I'm done with this radio show. And all my asshole talk, I sit here and say, I'm suspending you, firing you, and hell with Dirty John, and this and that. But in my heart, I felt like a quiver of nervousness and anxiety. And I felt like I had oppressed myself by attacking you, one of the two brothers that I have in my presence right now. I have a small inner circle of people. I will name them now for all time and space. Dirty John Winterbottom, Miracle Mark Wilcox, Filthy John Monez, Larry D, Brimstyle, The Smoking Man. Those are the members of my inner circle. I know you're whispering Chris Nicene to me, but the thing about it is, Chris Nicene are working out our issues. One of my best friends was Chris Nicene.
I'll deal with that. But you gotta admit, at one point, he was within the...
He was in my inner circle. But we have parted ways, in some
sort
ways,
of.
And amicably, but we are trying to mend things. And that is the beauty of real, true friendship.
And again, it all stems from being in a band, you know what I mean?
Which is so much like it's exactly the same as a romantic relationship.
It can really, this too. I mean, you know what I mean? I was thinking in the hallway, this is worse than being married.
But that's it. But don't you see all those, what's the word I'm looking for?
Not that I was.
All of those institutions, being in a band, being on the radio, being in love, having a girlfriend, being married, having children, it's all the same institution. It all depends on your level of passion.
And it gets intensified within a band because it's not just a one-on-one thing like a relationship. It's, you know, if there's four guys in the band, then you have dealing with, you know, three other people on that level.
And you know, what's up, Aaron? Give me a handshake because I love you. You know what? The truth of the matter is, when you have the four people in the band, I mean, I'm so against the communal artistic experience. I have to bend like crazy in order to... My ego... I'm the king of the superegos. And for my ego to bend to hear the... To hear other people's perceptions and ideas of what things... What the artistic experience should be like, sometimes very difficult for me. And I know I'm critical and difficult. You know, I know it. I know I'm so difficult. I don't know. I don't know. It's all because I think I'm trying to... suck in as much life as I can while I have it, because I don't think I'm going to get old, like I always say. Geez. So I live as hardcore as I can now, because I don't think, you know, I'm not. I just feel like I'm so scared that I'm going to be dead, and God's going to say, "Sorry, you're going to rot in a casket the rest of your life because you had no faith in anyone except yourself. You were selfish."
Isn't
and
that
vain.
Ultimately what happens to everybody? It's just a matter of how long you get to stay here. You want to play a song and pray for a while?
I'm going to fake my own death by dying. What do you think? I want to do a scream, and then I want to play the song. Primal Scream. Turn this music up for my Primal Scream, and then we go, I want to go right into this damn song. It's The Cringe. It's one of our new songs off
You'll
of our new album.
You'll be hearing this on Tuesday if you come.
Tuesday night at The Call, we're performing live. This is off our new album coming out called Pathos of Glory. It's called 3 Minute Goodbye, and it sums up every cliche that I exist within right now in my life, and my life has become a blistering and ugly and bloodless cliche. And I know I used bloodless before. I'm using it again because I'm verbally stunted. Look right there. See?
Here's just make sure you step back from that mic when you scream.
This is a scream. This is a scream for everything. This is a scream for the goddamn everything. Because it's not going to make me feel better. I don't know who it's going to make feel better. Louder with the music! Okay. We'll be back. Stay tuned. I love you. I love you. I love you. Don't ever pretend I don't. Yes, that was The Cringe. That was our goddamn band. I don't know. I'm going to mention it one more time. It's Tuesday night. It's at The Call in Providence. I don't know. If you come at 9 o'clock, you should be fine. Yeah. Don't come much later than that.
We probably won't go on until, I'm hoping, around 9:30, between 9:30 and 10.
Yeah. It's going to be a short burst of a set, but I promise you, I will be as dishonest as humanly possible with you up there. I will be as manipulative
you'll
and
be living the lie
as possible. Because you know what, ladies and gentlemen, my new mantra, this fascist kills machines. This fascist kills machines. I'm the anti-Woody Guthrie, period. Because at the end of the day, I only care about myself. I do this for my, to get what I want out of the world. Mm. If you agree or disagree or you get something from what we talk about on the air, fine. But I'm doing this because I live in a unicentric world, period. Dirty John, I believe you have a clever and whimsical anecdote to share.
No. Actually, it's probably more in-depth analysis of why I'm so miserable today.
What's the matter? Well, I've been asking you for an hour.
Well, last night...
Leave!
Last night, I got out of work kind of late. And I, like a jerk, go knocking on Miracle Mark's door at midnight.
Now, really quick, I had spoken to Miracle Mark at like 10:30 and he was already in bed.
So I come running into his house at midnight while he's in his pajamas, half asleep, hair sticking up. And I'm like, dude, we're going drinking tonight. We're going to go and we're going to go have some fun. He's like, what are you talking about? But I drag him out and I make him drive just to show what kind of a jerk I am. Okay. And so we went down to the green room, one of our new little hangouts, and we proceeded to get ourselves good and plastered, and I think basically today you can call me Johnny Hangover Winterbottom. That should be my name for today, because I think I'm having a weird type of hangover, not the usual. You wake up with a headache and you get sick. I'm just all funked out today because I couldn't sleep because I was all juiced up from being drunk. And then when we got home and I went to bed, or Miracle Mark went to bed, I called him again at 4:30 in the morning with some stupid ass tale because I was so drunk. So I feel bad for Miracle Mark, and I have to apologize for that because I sent him on a journey last night that
Mark's mad as hell, but he'll probably take it a little bit longer.
And we like to we like to drink. What can I say? I like my booze. I like to go down there and stare at the girls down at the green room.
I've been returning to that feeling of when I go to the bar that the green room or snooker is in, start drinking. I'm getting that feeling again of like John Wayne empowerment when I drink. Like I feel like everything is all right in my life when I've had too many drinks.
I know,
which is scary.
It gets me to do stuff I normally wouldn't. Wow, but I got a whole crowd.
This is
coming
it.
In
this
here
is
today.
A party tonight. Jesus. What's up, partiers? Welcome to the party. Goatee, wow. Clean faces. We should have a fist fight.
Speaking of the green room, I want to say hi to somebody who might be listening.
Your lady fair.
Miss Meredith. The sweet angel sent her down, and I stare at her like a psychopath when we go there, drooling.
Oh,
I
feel you're so winning now. This is good. This is good, damn it.
Oh, it's so bad. It's so bad.
I like that place we were saying earlier, because we go in, and we kind of know some of the people who work there, so there's some recognition and familiarity.
And this adds to the frustration, too. You know, I'm having the old lady problems, you know? I'm feeling like I want a lady, and I find, you know, you can't have the ones you want, and, you know, so...
No, but you can. You just don't have the confidence.
No. Hey, you know, I... after a couple drinks, I can actually go over there and talk to the girls.
You're Dirty John Winterbottom. You toured in a band for years and years through Europe with legions of people who would have bled for you and did bleed for you while you bled for them.
I know.
How many times did one, if not all of us, end up with bloody mouths during a show?
Many, many times.
And remember we went to AS220, we did that show, I think it was at March or something.
Right.
And I got the bottle in my head and it was like the most beautiful, nostalgic feeling, like a sign from, like I said earlier, something higher than me that said, return to this, you know? Yeah. Return to this.
That's why I want to do it, so we can get girls again, really.
Tuesday night at the call. Weird. I don't know what's going to happen.
Yeah.
Brand new bass player who's only been with us one time, Mad Matt Matthews.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, my God. We'll see. He's good. He's young upstart
really good.
Bass player.
He's helping us out.
Tuesday night at the call. By the way, real quick, we're going to take a couple calls. 792-9030 if you want to talk to us. 792-9030, the last few minutes for Kind Sounds. And I just want to quickly say, if you want to send me an email, and I love to get emails, and I'd like to get feedback, it's nopositive@aol.com. That's one word. nopositive@aol.com. Send me something. Tell me what you think. Tell me if any of this means anything to you, even if you completely hate this. Tell me, so I know. I don't feel so isolated. I live in an apartment all alone. I'm very isolated. I need connective tissue, people. And I'll do it I'll adhere myself to it electronically if I have to. Let's take a call. No Positive Radio.
What's up, Paul?
Is this Joe from No Offense?
Yeah.
Joe, I have to apologize to you.
Why?
I couldn't get to your show the other night.
Oh, yeah. I thought some guy was you, man, and I was like, what's up?
Oh my God! Yeah, I couldn't get there only because we had to break in this new bass player, and that was one of the only nights we could do it.
I swear, your twin was a
really
guy. My, looked just like you.
My
like,
doppelganger.
Up,
weird.
I was like, "What's up, Paul?" He just looked at me like I had 20 heads.
How was your show? Was it a good show?
Yeah, it was pretty good.
I'm glad.
Yeah, we had fun.
You know how much I believe in you guys. Do you understand that?
Yeah, I know.
I believe in you.
Yeah.
All right.
You should have seen today, man. We played a show at a cookout.
How was that?
It was friggin' horrible. There was like
you're gonna have many of those.
30, 40-year-old people.
Just, oh, that's the best show when
and
nobody
there was
likes
all
you.
60-year-old people there too.
Oh, I love those are the best shows, Joe.
You mess
yeah,
with
I
them.
Yeah, I know. They were just staring at us, and then
and
they,
you learned to play for yourself, right?
Yeah, and they clapped when we left. That was about
the
it.
The hell with them. Joe, you know I love you guys, and I you know that's it. I think you guys are one of the greatest punk bands that exist right now.
That's cool.
All right?
Yeah, I'll talk to you later.
Be good.
All right, then.
Yes, can I help you?
Did you get any no-plus graffiti at the State House or wherever?
No, I was desperately let down by the fact that... No, I wasn't let down. I can't expect craziness right off the bat. I'm trying to build an army of disaffected people, and I was hoping that I would wake up on Monday morning and somebody would have spray-painted no positive on the State House wall. I got some emails saying I was that people that wanted to do it.
Yeah.
I implore you to do it again. And the person who does it, and does it without being arrested. But if you are arrested, I only applaud you and love you even
more.
Then
we want you to paint it on the inside of the jail cell.
If you paint no positive, spray paint it on forget the State House, anywhere that the news media will pick up on it.
Do it on a cop car parked somewhere.
Do it on a cop car. Make some noise for me. Because I'm trying to speak for you. I'm not doing this for my own good. I'm not doing this because, you know, well, yes, I am. I'm doing it because I want to do it.
Yeah.
But I'll lie to you right now because I live the lie. Here I go, living the lie. I'm doing it for you. So do this for me. How's that?
I think he just hung up.
Yeah, that was the end of his feelings
okay.
on that.
Want to give out the number again?
I'm sorry again.
I know.
Do we feel all right now?
I'm fine.
Because I know you. You contain crap all day.
No, I'm not.
And then you go home and you're going to punch a wall thinking of my face.
No.
I only did it out of passion. I shouldn't have snapped. I'll regret that. Larry D., Filthy John Monez, and the beautiful Shelly Monez, who's going to be giving birth at any time to beautiful Ava Monez, who will be John's new daughter. Of course, I love you, the whole family. And Dolores, I love you, love you, love you, love you, love you, Dolores. Mr. and Mrs. Larry and Jean DiGiusto, my second parents... How much do I love you? I love you with everything. I love my mother with everything. Damien, Alexandra, Kristen, I love all of you. Bill Parker, I love you. Brimstyle and Smoking Man, I love you. I love you people at home. James and No Offense and everyone else, I love you all. Miracle Mark and Jennifer, I love you.
It's love Phil's show today.
But I mean it. The only sincerity is that's my sincerity. I really do love you people. I really do. Truthfully.
Or we wouldn't still be doing this.
No. I love you, Aaron. And I love you, goatee guy. You're welcome.
What about old Bill Parker?
I said I love Bill. Come here. Come on, Bill. Pat on
I don't
the,
think you
here,
tell Bill
here.
You love him enough.
Pat on the back. Hold each other. Let's hold. No, hold each other.
You guys should see this. It's
Let's
a beautiful sight.
No, come on, don't do that. You're supposed to hold me. One more call.
Okay.
Hurry up. We're about to be done. I don't want to go over kind sounds. Hello. Hi there.
Hey.
Larry D!
What a great show.
Are you having a good time?
Yeah, it's really good. A lot of drama. I said to the Miracle that you couldn't write something this funny and this on point, you know?
It's dramatic.
Oh, it goes
it's real.
Religion to berating Joe, which is always, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What are you doing
you know,
tonight?
My friend Joe Brown.
Yep.
All right, well, I'm going to go with my friend Joe Brown.
See you later, Joe Brown and Larry D.
Wow.
He must have had some rum and coke.
Oh, boy. He started
God
early
bless
tonight.
Him. Let's end this show. It's a calamity. I want to thank a bunch of guests. Bill Parker, of course, host of the Children's Show, Sundays 5 to 8 p.m. Larry D., Tattoo Artist, ElectricInkTattoo.com. Thank the callers. I want to thank Aaron. Aaron's up next with Kind Sounds, the greatest source of hippie music you're ever going to find in your life. Till next week, next Sunday night at 8, this is Paul Hullabaloo asking you kindly to subject, oppose, subvert, and always leave the lie. Yeah, 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 yeah.